Hello and welcome to the NASGP podcast, The Art of GP Locuming. Today, this evening, I'm recording at approximately 8 p.m. and I'm talking to Dr Jennie Ferrie, who is a GP locum in New Zealand. And I'm talking live to Jennie now, and it's just gone 7 o'clock in the morning for Jennie. It's the merry month of May, coming towards the end of May. So Jennie, good morning. Welcome to the NASGP podcast. We've known each other for many, many years. You've been in New Zealand for 10 years now, but do you want to just sort of just run us through what you were doing in your career-wise before you came to New Zealand? What helped you decide to change and what have you been doing there?
I guess you should start by saying is I had quite an international background. I was born and brought up in Singapore, where my father had been an architect. And it really wasn't until my sixth form and medical school that I came to UK. So I did my medical school at University College London. And after that, worked a few house jobs and senior house jobs in paediatrics in London. I married a Dutchman who took me then over to Holland. And I continued my paediatric training in Amsterdam. That was for sort of 2 or 3 years. And then with sort of children coming on the way, we returned to UK. And that's when I completed my GP training in Sussex, which is near to where you are, Richard. So with a couple of little children, we actually then went back to Singapore. And I worked a bit of private practice in Singapore and also did some emergency medicine with SOS. But then with 3 children, my husband in the oil industry at that time, we really needed to kind of settle down and give the kids a home. So we came back to West Sussex and I became a GP partner at a practice, practiced about 13,000 patients. And I was a GP partner for 19 years.
Wow.
So that was great. All the children grew up in, you know, lovely little Sussex village. And it was when the last of the children were off to university and actually all of Michael's and my parents had died, we suddenly found ourselves with this, you know, opportunity to go away and do something.
Wow. And of course, by this stage, you mentioned West Sussex, yes, but I've stayed in West Sussex that entire time. You've been globetrotting around the world. It sounds like going to foreign countries and moving up lock, stock and barrel doesn't seem to faze you. Do you think that's been part of this, your upbringing in terms of sort of international travel and moving around?
Yes, I mean, absolutely. That's why I sort of mentioned that, although we were very stable for that sort of 20 years, really. The ability to go and work in different cultures and, you know, be with different people has very much been part of my upbringing.
Yeah.
Yes, that in itself didn't seem too difficult. I mean, logistically, it's lots to do, but... Mm. The mental factor of saying, oh, well, we're going to go away for a couple of years, because that's what it was, a nice sabbatical, didn't seem so difficult. But we did think we were coming back when we went.
Right.
I mean, obviously, for UK doctors, the relatively easier countries to get to are Australia, New Zealand, and I believe Canada, but I didn't make any investigations into Canada.
And what made you choose New Zealand? Well, that was because your husband had a job there, or just the opportunity arose?
My husband has primarily been, since we moved to studying, the sort of caregiver for the children. It was very much on my position. I had never been to New Zealand. I had heard of this wonderful, romantic place called the Bay of Islands, which seemed absolutely idyllic. And a Singapore friend had been a doctor there. But then what was so interesting was one of my partners at my British practice, she decided to go on a 2-year sabbatical and never came back. And she's actually a colleague of mine here in the Bay of Islands.
So you've both stayed out there. You've both stayed, have you?
Yes. Wow. Yes. And there were so many funny other little connections that happened about the time, as they always do, which brought me to this area of New Zealand. So no, but those are the two ones really, as I say, an old friend here, and as I say, one of my GP partners.
And how did you then start working in practice then? Was that, did you go straight into locuming? Did you need a visa? How was that all arranged?
So there are agencies that come over, and I think they advertise quite often and give conferences. And probably the main agency that recruits from, particularly from UK and from Holland, but Denmark, Canada, everywhere, is called New Zealand Locums. And this locum agency is, I understand, is what they call a non-for-profit. So it's particularly trying to help out the GP practices that are in rural areas and just cannot recruit. So this might be a single GP or be two GPs who just cannot get a locum and therefore cannot get away on holiday.
Right.
So New Zealand locums will, with some government sponsorship, help to get them a locum and use, as I say, the international locums that they're trying to recruit to do this. I think basically it doesn't charge them all the usual locum fees, which I think can be quite hefty for the practices. New Zealand medical practice has been largely based on UK practice. It's changing now, but you still have the sort of traditional GP partner-owned practices. So, as I say, there are still probably less than 50% now, but that was definitely the model of GP practices, was that partners would own the practices. So that was contact through the locum agencies. They can be very, very helpful in terms of getting all your paperwork together, although you can do it by yourself. There's a New Zealand immigration online is lots and lots and lots and lots of tick boxes, but they're all there. I think anybody thinking of applying, for me in particularly because I had traveled and been in different countries, it was terribly important to keep a complete log of your working history.
Right.
So for instance, after 20 years of working in one practice, you think that, you know, that's pretty stable. On my form, I missed out, I think, about sort of 3 months between travel from Singapore back to UK back in the 1980s. And some little tick busher had picked that up and sent the form back. What were you doing in these 3 months?
Right, right.
So very careful to make sure that your dates literally all add up. So if you've had any sort of, you know, breaks between jobs, however short, make sure you put something on the list. And I was just going to say, otherwise, it should take about 3 months, 3 to 4 months, and you do need some sort of medical.
And do you need someone in New Zealand to sort of sponsor you as such, or give you a reference or anything like that?
Yes. No, fundamentally, you need to have a job.
Right.
So the person that's going to sponsor you on your work visa will be the people that you are being placed with. So the local agency will find you a job. The job will then give you your employment, and that will be your sponsor.
And when you start in that job then in New Zealand, do you have to stick with that in that one practice for all that time you're there? Or can you? Is there a stage when you can then maybe locum for other practices like we might do in the UK, or is it different in New Zealand?
No, you can change. So when you get your contract from your practice, there's usually a sort of 3 month severance on either side. Now, of course, the practice has worked hard to get you and they probably really want you. But the duration of time, many overseas doctors will just come for 3 months. 6 months, if they have come for a year or 2 years, obviously the practices are desperate, they want to keep you, but actually no. If you come through one of the more commercial agencies, I think the practices will have had to pay a fairly hefty amount to get you. They don't pay travel and relocation. Although I have heard that there's something quite new to try, because they're really trying to get GPs across, there is some kind of relocation fee that you can get if you stay within a practice for 1 or 2 years. And then the practice can apply for that on your behalf. So that's just been a recent, and I haven't looked into the ins and outs, but a little sort of recent, yeah, incentive, get people over. But I came over and I did 9 months with the first practice. And then I actually changed. I got a further job that I went to a practice in Gisborne, which is the East Coast, and then I moved up to the Bay of Islands. But whilst you're on a working visa, you do need to be contracted and employed by a practice. So essentially, you can say, well, is that locuming? Because you actually are employed. The next thing I then did was, after 2 years, because I decided we were going to stay, we were given the ability to apply for residence. Now, once I had residence, I could then, what I call, properly work, self-employed as a local. And this meant that I could now move into the sphere of, you know, choosing whichever practice I wanted to work at. But as I say, the first couple of years you do work for a practice, but it may be just a 3-month contract.
And I imagine if it's a new country and you're not used to it, that having that stability and that continuity in one place to really get to know the ropes must be super helpful to get embedded in a place.
Yeah, you're still called a locum when you're in the practice. And as I say, it's generally, in come summertime here, so from about November, December, all the overseas locums come. And so they're coming from America, they're coming from Canada, or for all the ones from the Northern Continent, Denmark, UK, Holland, and they very often come, quite interesting, lots of them come year after year, and they come for sort of 3 or 4 months. So they do their 3-month job, and then they do a bit of travel, and then they go back to Europe probably come about sort of now, really, April, May. They'll all be going back for summer again, you see.
It sounds like animal migration, like some sort of swallow or something.
Well, that's what they're called. They're quite a lot of people who do, in various professions, swallow here. So they, you know, they'll have a home here, particularly Americans, actually. They'll have a home here. They'll spend 3 or 4 months.
Sounds almost too good to be true. I think you might have just let out a big secret there, because that sounds like a very attractive thing to do during the winter months.
And it is relatively easy. I mean, obviously, you know, you have to pack up your house. And once you've seen that the process works, it is just a process, a tick box process. Yeah.
And then so you arrived in New Zealand 10 years ago with your husband, and you started as a GP in this practice. How did, and having been a partner for 20 years, how did it, what were the big differences that you can remember? What were the, any shocks, any surprises, any delight? How did you find it? It'd be interesting to know too, what the sort of the change in pace or tempo was with seeing patients. Were you seeing more or less patients? How does it all work?
I think that when I first arrived, it was obviously getting used to the computer system, but that's like any computer system, your PMS. So that was a little bit different. Again, I would say is that the whole fundamental structure of primary and secondary care is very similar. So I didn't feel that there was any significant cultural change. So whereas I know in countries like Europe, the role of specialists, dermatologists, pediatricians, is much closer to the patient front.
Right.
And patients can book directly, whereas New Zealand is very much GP gatekeepers. Some people have private insurance. It's a small percentage. But that, again, works. The private consultants are consultants that work in the public system. So, again, very, very similar. The process of referring into hospital, again, very similar. And by the way, most of the junior house officers are from UK or Australia. I mean, I worked with, you know, doctors from every country, but hardly any from New Zealand, because they've all gone off to Australia. the GPs are a real international group, which is quite fun. But as I say, particularly for the Americans, it's a bit of a different culture of practice. So it's been quite fun to work with them and to see how they practice and consult and everything like that. Generally, I think all appointments are about 15 minutes. I have worked in some particularly challenging practices where they give you 20 minutes. And this has been in areas where they say low decile, so that's low socioeconomic, multiple morbidity practices. So I have had a couple of practices where I've had 20 minutes. But I have found that those have been more chaotic practices. And of course, they're double booked. So I feel 20 minutes is not 20 minutes. By and large, the practices, you know, we do just have the 15-minute appointments, and then there'll be another GP who will be on for the acutes and managing, you know, that side. So again, pretty similar, you know, like your duty doctor you have in England. I found that, as I say, practice-wise, it feels still, and I hope I don't tread on any toes here, it does feel behind the UK, and by I mean behind is our access to secondary care investigations, even like ultrasound, is limited. And geographically, I mean, New Zealand's 5 million people spread over a huge area. Mm. Getting access to secondary care investigations is really tough. There's also a bit of complacency from the patients. Well, you know, if you have to travel 2 hours, you know, to go and get an x-ray, it's pretty, you know, doesn't make you want to go there. So I find that things are quite slow and delayed in terms of being able to get patients investigated.
I was going to ask that because certainly my experience, I think a lot of our experience here in the UK at the moment, is the waiting lists are just getting longer and longer and longer, and you're getting this phenomenon of sort of echoing, right? Where so rather than you see a patient, traditionally you would refer them, they would then get seen. Instead, they're bouncing between primary and secondary care because they can't get the access to secondary care, so they're coming back again, bouncing back to primary care, for second, third, fourth consultations for the same thing where previously that would have been done in one go. Is that what's happening in New Zealand?
There's a lot of that, I think, as well. As a GP, you're writing your second and third letter back to the consultant. Yeah. There you saw this guy, this was supposed to happen, that was supposed to happen, it's not happened, and this has happened with the patient, but I can't order the test. We know he needs a CT scan, or we know he needs this, but it's not happening.
So it's so like British general practice, then.
So I would say so like general practice. It's just, I've seen that throughout my career. I think you kind of leave from medical school thinking you know everything and everything can be done, and more into practice, you know, you know what should be done, but the ability to get your patient to receive those services and that intervention is just widening and widening. The gap is becoming so big between what's actually achieved for the patient and what we know should be achieved.
In the UK now, in the last sort of 6, 8, 9 months, there's been a big increase in we call them ARS roles. So these are clinicians, but they're not doctors. They might have had. They're younger, but they could be paramedics, or they might have done a couple of years training in primary care, but very much not about undifferentiated care. It's very much differentiated care, and there's been a lot of funding for these ARS roles to take up positions in general practice, which is in many areas kind of edged GP locums out. So a lot of GPs are finding it much harder now to get work, having to travel further in order to sort of pick up those sessions. In New Zealand, have you got these roles? Is that something that's happening in New Zealand as well?
And I just think we're just a few years behind you. But the problem is we don't have the nurses either. So nurses have been, for a number of years, encouraged to take on nurse practitioner roles and nurse prescribing roles. And I would say that, by and large, the nurses, you know, the usual practice nurses have taken on much more of the diversity of care than I saw in England. So what I found in England was we had excellent chronic care nurses doing the diabetes and all of that. But we had less nurses participating in the demand on the day. So I always call that as the sort of flexibility of work, the ability to change between seeing acutes and seeing non-acutes and trying to time manage. Those kind of roles are being taken up by nurse practitioners now. Seeing the more diversity, being more on the front line, doing the triage. Actually, nurses here are involved a lot in the GP triage and particularly in the after-hours triage.
Okay.
Yes, they are trying to encourage the practitioners, what do they call them, the PA, which seems a more American thing to me in practices. Mm. The Americans seem to have brought these in, the assistant, what do they call it, assistant associate. I think this is individuals, but I have worked with a physician's associate on a few times, and I found it absolutely marvellous. Because all that kind of drudgery of paperwork and follow-up and all of that, you can just pass. So working with them, I found extremely good. Has it made me see more patients? I don't know. Patients' problems just seem to be more and more complicated. what I mean is your one patient now has five or six issues that need to be, you know, moved forward. But I've definitely found physicians associates in terms of being able to schedule minor ops and, as I say, follow up with a consultant about something. They've been very good. I haven't seen them so much work independently, you know, initiating and completing consultations. I haven't really worked with them in that score.
Right, because that's more my personal experience of in a practice of one is very much the physician associates are there seeing patients and not doing, not in any way helping with the paperwork kind of thing. It may well be that the usage, so it sounds like what you might be talking about is more like of a personal assistant type of role.
Again, as I say, this is a limited experience, but that seemed to it. Yes, I think there are personal assistants who also just hold their own list and see their own patients.
Right.
We don't yet have the paramedics in practice. And actually, a lot of our people who work with the ambulance with St John's are voluntary. Oh. It's incredible. Still voluntary. And that's, you know, as well, like the firemen are all voluntary. Gosh. So we have to be quite careful when we call ambulances to actually check, you know, what grade the, you know, the person is.
So it sounds then that in many ways, general practice, the sort of the day job is very similar. Do you have long days? Do they grind on into the evening?
Again, as I say, working as a locum as opposed to a partner, I think the partners have had it really difficult and wet because they can't get locums. And therefore, I think that, you know, speak to a partner and it might be a bit different from what I say.
Uh-huh.
So I think there's two things here, and is that in general, the work-life balance in New Zealand, in my experience, is pretty good. So for most professions, they will be looking at packing up at 5 o'clock and going home and going and doing something. And that's not going to the pub. You know, they are then out sailing or going to their rugby or going to their netball or going to this or going to that. Everybody respects that. So you do not have, I mean, in any of the practices I've seen is, you know, people sludging behind their desk at 6, 7, 8 o'clock at night.
They've got somewhere else to go. There's somewhere else to be.
They've got somewhere else and it's respected.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's
value.
It's not expected that you should be finishing your paperwork off.
Oh, God, this could all be due to Netflix, couldn't it? That seems to be the sort of almost like the drug of choice. Maybe I'm speaking for myself here. But now that is interesting. Is that because the communities are smaller, perhaps, in New Zealand? Is that one more isolated? Is that anything to do with it?
I think there is this feeling as you go off, you work hard, you do your day's job, you know, you feel good about it and, you know, you put it down. But I think that's changing. It's a culture that's changing more. And I think, you know, as I say, since most people can work from home at some, you know, some point or time of day, I'm not sure whether the younger generation are starting to do more and more work at home. But as I say, in the GP practice, when 5 o'clock happens, the lights go off, and everybody's ready to leave. So, you know, you as a locum, you know, you don't get given a key. And that's it. Shut the doors.
Wow. Five o'clock, you say?
5 o'clock. God. So they did try to bring in some later surgery times. And they have tried in various places developing these, you know, after-hour centres. But most of them, I think, it's then the telephones will go through to a call centre. The nurse will answer the call centre. The nurse will triage whether the patient needs to be seen and arrange for them to be seen at one of these out-of-hour centres.
And are there opportunities for GP locums to work at those out-of-hour centres if they wanted to as well?
Oh, yes. Yep. No, there are lots. And I think that this is where the bigger out-of-hour centres are, of course, more in the towns. And these are with people like Southern Cross insurance agencies, you know, more the sort of private sector has come in to run these. So, yes, there is. And, you know, as far as I'm aware, they're all hiring. Yeah. And of course, there's a big explosion now for remote teleconsult.
Is that something you've done at all?
Well, yes, I do remote work as well. That's part of my locum work. So my job now, later on today, is from home. And I'll be covering a practice down in South Island.
As an organisation, over the last years, we've developed a sort of like an Airbnb platform for locums. So the locums come on as a host, and then it's the practice managers come along onto the platform as customers, and they can click and book a locum. And we've got about 100 or so remote locums and practices, and they can book a remote locum from one end of the country. What do you have similar systems like that in New Zealand then? How do you arrange this work in the Southern Island from the north?
Well, there are two ways it gets worked. It's either, I'd say, since COVID and since all the practices went remote and realised that actually there was a fair portion of their workload that they really could do remotely. It can happen so that if, say, I've worked at a locum practice and I then say I'd like to work remotely with you one day a week and the work is there, they'll do it. There's In one practice I'm working at the moment, one of the doctors moved. So she moved from the area to another area in New Zealand, and she got on really well with everybody. And so she continued her job with that practice because she had moved away. So that kind of thing works. Then there is various locum agencies that are particularly doing the the remote access. So they have their collection of, you know, GPs that work under them, and then they have their relationship with the practices. And what they do is they try to set you up with, to keep with the same practice. But they're pretty good. IT can sometimes be an issue, but we have two or three main PMS systems. So it can get a bit confusing as you jump from one to the other.
Yes.
But basically, everything can be done within the PMS. So all the certificates, all the referrals, all the accident forms, all the lab requests, the scripts, everything is electronic.
The PMS, that's the IT system, is it?
Yes, that's the IT system.
How does it work as a locum in New Zealand in terms of meeting other locums? Is there any peer support networks or learning groups or chambers or anything like that where you get together?
So trying very much on the UK kind of model, and they say, yes, we should, because our appraisal system, again, was based on the UK model, as far as I can see. And so, yes, there should be the peer support. What you have in practices, you know, we had one on Monday. There are three branches to this practice. We stopped at lunchtime and somebody gave a little talk, and then everybody had the opportunity of talking in. So peer review is very much there. In one of the locum agencies I'm attached to, which is the one that does the remote work, yes, they have peer review. If you're kind of working on your own, which is quite a lot of what I've done up in the north, which is quite a remote area, you can begin to feel quite isolated. One of the practices I worked with, although there were two doctors, were both working part-time, so I think there was only one day a week we actually crossed over. And I would say again that since COVID, pre-COVID, there used to be quite a lot of kind of meetings once a month within your district area. And they kind of tailed off.
Right.
A lot more of the meetings are happening on Zoom. You know, the accredited meetings that you get your sort of CBD points are happening on Zoom. So I think that is, I think that's potentially something, especially when you're new coming here. You know, and if you were in a particularly small practice, you could find it a bit isolating.
Yeah.
I probably also see that within the practices I've worked, and they've been terribly friendly. And I mean, it's a very, I'd say, egalitarian country here. So everybody kind of mixes in to do everything. You know, your peer support are your receptionists and are your nurses, and anybody working, you know, within the building.
Are there other opportunities in sort of in terms of sort of portfolio work, for example, in such as being appraisers and that kind of thing? But also in the UK, we have groups of practice for every three, four, five, six practices sort of come together to form these. Well, these can network with each other, these primary care networks, and there are leadership roles in that, and there are also leadership roles at sort of health board, integrated care board level, we call them. Do you have anything similar in New Zealand?
Yes. I mean, I think that there's lots of, again, just gone through another major sort of change, but I mean, there is, so we would have Northland District Health Board. And that would cover sort of the, you know, the Northland areas, and Auckland will obviously have its own separate, you know, district health board. So yes, the country is divided up into different regions. Again, as I say, the regions will have all things that they are trying to get forward for their own regions. And they love to have GPs getting involved to try to help to push forward with the services, which are, again, they have to get through contracts. So if, for instance, you know, quite recently, steroid injections are, not many GPs are really doing steroid injections. Right. So they say is, okay, we need to then upskill some GPs, you know, in this area to be able to do the steroid injection. They can't wait to have some GP take that on and, you know, arrange for the consultant to come, or they'll, you know, the admin will obviously support you, but get the GPs all together, get them upskilled in training. Then, as I say, is you know, there's some contract that the PHO, we call them, the primary health, will get funding streams for. And they're always wanting these kind of initiatives.
Okay.
The training, the GP training scheme is very, very similar to the UK GP training scheme. It's a little bit longer. I haven't been involved in it. But doctors will spend a couple of years at the practices at the end, but very similar. You've got, as I say, there are so many English GPs, and because the system is so aligned on the English system, everywhere we go in all levels of administration, there are UK GPs who have moved into it. Because I think there are a lot of GPs who came like me for two years and then said, well, actually, hold on. You know, I'm going to stay. So everywhere I go, there are people. I think there was a big tranche of GPs who came, who are of my sort of vintage, who came in their early 20s, you know, before children, and subsequently stayed and have become, you know, total New Zealanders. And then I think there's another big tranche of GPs later in life who've done the sort of think I'm going to go for the sabbatical thing, and ended up staying here, who you then talk to. And I mean, they might have come with children to go to school. You know, they might have come with, you know, school-age children and just stayed. But they're very involved in all aspects of clinical governance and everything else.
When you and your husband are out walking in the beautiful mountains, or maybe sailing around the islands, or doing whatever you're doing, do you ever say to yourselves, gosh, how lucky we are? Or do you ever have any regrets? Do you ever talk about perhaps coming back to England? Or
I think the biggest thing facing anybody, particularly families coming here, is that it's so jolly far away.
Yeah.
You can't just go over to Europe and say, oh, well, I'll just pop back for a weekend. or even the feeling about the States, well, I'll get on a plane for the weekend. Mm. I mean, it is far. And I think that's the rub, if you like, is that, you know, you've left, you know, by and large, most of your friends,
yeah,
and, you know, a lot of your family you will have left behind. And Zoom doesn't cut it. You know, no. It's nice to see them, but it's not the same contact. I think on the other side, you're absolutely right. I mean, the view is my view behind me. I did it as a screenshot because it's up, but it's just there starting. It's now light has come. And I just have to kick myself. It is just so beautiful. As I say, the you know, the gentler pace of lifestyle and the liberty to do, I find incredible. So yes, it is like saying, goodness me, I live in this amazing world. And
yeah.
You know, by and large, the people are you know, are very accommodating. You do have, of course, the whole of the Maori side, which is very interesting. I mean, you know, both medically and for the people to understand where they've come from. And basically, you know, there's a lot of bitterness still to the colonization. So there are racial issues here that's undoubted. But I mean, by and large, again, it's a happy people. Everybody has their complaints, but you know, as you say, they're out and about sailing and walking and playing all the sports, and they're very much a family, community-based people. So it is a good life. It is a really, really good life. I mean, that's why we haven't come back. We had come back frequently. I mean, we've been pre-COVID, we used to come back every year, every summer, and I did work in England. So I would come back for sort of 2 to 3 months and pick up locum work for a couple of months. And then COVID hit, and I was in England throughout COVID because I couldn't get back. So I have continued to keep tabs on yeah. what's been going on. But yes, I would definitely say it is less stressful, and working as a locum is definitely less stressful.
What would you say to, let's say, a newly qualified GP, let's say in their early 30s, with a partner and maybe a young toddler and another kid on the way, and they're struggling to pick up work and their partner's job is flexible? What would you say to them in terms of giving New Zealand a go for a bit?
I would say absolutely 100%. They would, you know, fit in anywhere, particularly, and personally, I don't think you go to New Zealand necessarily for the cities unless you have to.
Right.
You know, so you know, UK cities are beautiful and old and traditional. My son and daughter now live in Auckland, and I mean, it is a great city, but it's not what I would be, not personally what I would be saying, you know, go to Auckland. Wellington's a smaller city, a bit more cultural, but very windy, I understand. And then the other cities are really pretty small, actually. Canterbury, Christchurch is the third.
Mm.
So there are cities, and all the cities do have their own quirks. And as I say, when you think with young people, they possibly, unless they are rural people, don't want to be too out in the sticks. But they will go into any community and immediately be able to mix in. Kids go to school. No, they will. I feel they'll be honestly welcomed with open arms.
Right.
And particularly the young children. Do you know what I mean?
It's yeah.
Particularly, that is not. We have lots of friends again who come and travel in New Zealand with, you know, 6 months older and 3 years and. You see them on all the trails. All the little kids are out walking the trails. So no, it's a pretty child friendly environment.
And what about things like culture and music and art and films and cinema and theatre? Are those opportunities around?
A little. So I mean, in the major cities in the summer, there are lots of festivals. The kids all seem to go to lots of music festivals, and you know, there's always things going, but it's on a much smaller scale. I mean, again, we only have 5 million people. And again, in terms of shows, you would have to be going to the main centres, Wellington or Auckland. Yeah. So, you know, the Royal Ballets from most countries come through here, and various, you know, performances do come through. And in fact, as I say, there's probably quite a high density of the international shows that come through.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't say you want to come to New Zealand to go to international shows.
No.
You come to New Zealand to, as I say, to do the hikes and to canoe down rivers and go fishing.
So if you're diehard Taylor Swift fan, just stay at home.
Yeah. No, we didn't get her, did we? No. No, she didn't come through here. And lots of people from New Zealand went over to, I think, to Singapore and to Australia.
It's their loss. Well, Jennie, it's been really lovely talking to you. It's been really interesting. And I hope our audience, who are largely GPs in the UK, have got a real good flavour and a sense of how much you...
Now, I was going to say is, I mean, if you do have these nice young families, I mean... Just, I'd say, is do things. It's just beware is when they come, they won't want to go home.
Right.
Okay. And they will have parents and conflicts. But definitely for locums, consider the, as I know many locums who come many different times, you know, year after year after year.
Yeah.
And that really suits them well.
Well, I think you've sold it really well. Thank you so much. not that's what this is about, but it's really good to hear that. It's lovely to hear the other side and to know there are other opportunities out there as well. And it sounds like a great place to live and work. So thank you very much, Jennie Ferrie, and have a really good start to your day now for the rest of your day. And this is thank you for tuning into the NESGB podcast. It's been, we really value you tuning in. This podcast will, subject to Jennie's approval, also be on YouTube as well. I'm sure it will. And so thank you for joining. And please subscribe on all your podcast channels for more of these. So thanks very much. And thank you, Jennie, again.
Well, lovely to speak with you. Have a great summer.
And you too.